It's not Black history, it's America's history.
I teach them life traits.
You just gotta give it all you got.
What I hope I'm doing is shifting their perception of life.
It takes two to change your life.
So this will be our home.
We do mentor others and support others who are pursuing their dreams.
What's the most you sold one for?
25, 30,000.
Never let it die.
Now, a WPBF 25 News Project Community Special, celebrating Black History Month with Stephen Graves and Jay Jarvis.
Good evening. We're joining you from the Spady Cultural Heritage Museum in Delray Beach,
where people are dedicated to discovering, collecting, and sharing African-American history.
The museum is inside the former home of the late Solomon D. Spady, the most prominent African-American educator and community leader in the city.
The walls are full of rich history, like this temporary exhibit, Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority. It highlights America's first Black sorority created in 1908 at Howard University.
They currently have more than 1,000 chapters and more than 325,000 members. This group was expanding during a time period where segregation was normalized.
This is the era we start with tonight, a story which happened nearly 300 miles away. It's been 100 years since the Rosewood Massacre in Central Florida. 5 Black people and 2 white people were killed.
It began with a racist mob and a claim from a white woman that she was attacked by a Black man.
Tiffany Kenny traveled to the once prosperous town, which was left in fiery ruins.
Rosewood, Florida, Borders Highway 24.
Lizzie Robinson Jenkins sings about a past that for years was unspeakable.
Where emptiness resides in the silent sacred breeze.
As you grew up, your family didn't talk about Rosewood.
No.
But you felt it.
Yes.
Jenkins felt the secret pain suffered by her aunt, Maholda Carrier.
This would have been right before she started teaching in Rosewood.
Maholda was Rosewood's school teacher for 8 years. She survived the massacre when a white mob forced Black families from their homes and burned the town down. Maholda never talked about it.
I knew she was in pain because of her mannerism. She was not at all herself. I knew something was wrong. I could just feel the energy that she was not a happy person.
What happened to Maholda and her husband, Aaron Carrier, is what started the week-long racial violence. On New Year's Day, 1923, a white married woman from a nearby town falsely accused Maholda's husband of rape. When he wouldn't confess to the crime, the angry mob interrogated Maholda about her husband's whereabouts.
They put a rope around her neck, put her in the car, and took her to Sumner. We're going to ask you one damn last time, where was your husband last night? And she looked at them and said, with the guns pointed at her head, she escalated her voice. My husband was at home with me all night long. And they said, oh, a bigoted bitch, let's rape her. And When they said, let's rape her, she told my mom her heart dropped. And they did exactly that.
Maholda was rescued by the county sheriff, Bob Walker, who, along with local train conductors, secretly helped her escape on a midnight train that brought her to her family in Archer.
They needed to get out of town with whatever they were wearing. Some of them didn't have sufficient clothes, and it was cold, no shoes. Some of them, I understand, started walking through the swamp, never returned, never saw them again.
Rosewood is about an hour southwest of Gainesville. The homes, businesses, and churches that were once a part of this thriving community are now all gone, wiped off the map. But there is this in the middle of this country road here, the outline of a simple foundation of a home that once stood here.
The long road to healing for Maholda never came.
She told my mom she never felt clean afterwards. She was miserable for the rest of her 25 years that she lived, running, moving. She changed her name 5 times. She moved more than 10 times. She was always looking over her shoulder.
Scared to death.
Scared to death. These are handkerchiefs that she saved. This was her collection.
Aww.
Jenkins runs the Real Rosewood Foundation and has spent most of her life preserving and protecting her aunt's story, only recently discovering perhaps another secret her aunt held close.
So when you ask me if she had kids, I don't know if she was pregnant. If she was pregnant and had bought these. Oh. Little booties.
They're so special.
They are so special.
Oh.
I couldn't ask my mom because she was no longer around. I never looked in here. But I don't know.
So that's another unanswered question.
Another unanswered question. That's history. Mom said, preserve it, authenticate it, and never let it die. Because we are history. And without history, she would tell me, you're nothing if you don't have any history. You can't change history. It's not about you, baby. I was a baby. I never grew up. It's not about you. Tell people for the next generation. It's not Black history. It's America's history. A destroyed town. No Blacks live there anymore. Where emptiness resides in the silent sacred trees. Life there no more, only nature's moss-hung trees.
Maholda Carrier eventually went back to working with children as a principal not far from Rosewood. She was just 54 when she passed away in 1948.
A few years later, a new era was born. In the early 1950s, a group of 26 African-American artists known as the Florida Highwaymen got on the road.
Highwaymen artist Al Black considers his paintings alive and complete when you see the Florida landscapes in a frame.
Why this frame?
For the sunset.
Okay.
That's the right color.
But depictions of this beauty start off all from memory.
And you can see it.
I can see it.
Even the colors, the...
Colors, yeah. The
trees,
the margin lines, the down to the detail.
And that's how you know it's a God-given gift.
Yes, a God-given gift.
How is it when you step back and look at it?
A gift God used to change his life. He really saw the power of it during a drug addiction in his younger years, which led him to prison.
I went from prison to prison of pain. You know, like if I go over to one prison, God, the warden, and I always see the ones I had did in that, and they asked me, would I come? I said, you have to ask my warden. You got to know what you're putting under him.
The vivid memories of these landscapes translated into artwork on state prison walls.
I think the most impressive part is you take what's in the sky and reflect it on the water. Because that's tough to do.
Painting supplies were donated to him while he was in custody so he could make the murals.
I've been clean for 28 years.
Does painting help you? Painting help you?
Yeah, and the prison helped me.
It did.
It was the best thing ever happened to me. I was in there for 12 years. It turned my whole life back around.
It was a recovery after a fall from grace of sorts. The famous artist lived well before his addiction. He was brave and a master at selling art in Fort Pierce in the 1960s during segregation.
Some of them would run me out, but I would say, oh, I'm not real Black, so I'm sunburnt. You know, that would pick things up, and I could go back again and sell something. And so I left the doors open.
He would sell the art with about a dozen of his fellow Black artists, learning how to paint along the way. The group later became known as the Highwaymen because they sold pieces roadside.
A couple of guys didn't want to be called the Highwaymen, but I felt like we were the Highwaymen because we stayed on the Highwaymen. And that Highwayman named them, bought our Black a long way.
He is still selling the paintings that have gone from being worth a few dollars to thousands.
What's the most you sold one for?
I done sold the painting for $25,000, $30,000.
Now, after having nothing as a tribute to the historic painters originating in Fort Pierce, they're getting a museum this year in the city. A long time coming for the group that gave art a new face.
I feel like I'm on go and lay down one day. And I want to be able to leave something back where somebody else will say, well, Al taught me this here.
Now, at the age of 76, as he steadies his hand to paint, he's passing along those skills to another generation.
I'm a descendant of Mr. Alfred Hare.
That's good. That's good.
Mm-hmm. You got to remember, there's only a few highwaymen left.
You drop that shout.
And I think the descendants have to continue to carry this legacy on.
Johnny Bennett's uncle was one of the most famous highwaymen, Alfred Hare. Bennett is now picking up the skill, hoping to pass it on to his son.
Take your brush and clean it out.
Learning from a man who knows best.
We're starting to really get into the lessons, so hopefully I'll be able to pick it up and just carry it on from there.
A legacy living on in more ways than one.
And it will live on. A museum is slated to open this year along Avenue D in Fort Pierce.
Coming up.
I hope that I'm guiding them to be future leaders and role models.
Marching towards a goal. The local band practicing to perform in London. Plus,
I'm gonna go ahead and become that mentor that those kids probably didn't have.
Influencing children through music and dance. The man behind the movement. You're watching Project Community, celebrating Black History Month.
5 years ago, during Black History Month, a local man took a life-changing step.
After composing for marching bands and performing in them, since he was a boy, he formed his own.
Once a member of the legendary FAMU Marching 100, he now leads a one-of-a-kind community band.
And as anchor Todd McDermott explains, the plan now is to lead them to London.
I got a $20 bill. Only one winner. Only one. Let me get a big warrior. Let me get a big warrior. Let me get a big.
Warrior!
Oh, y'all ready, ready.
Welcome to Antoine Miller's Dream Come to Life.
One, two, three.
One he teaches, coaches, and composes every day of his life. The Sounds of Success Warriors Community Marching Band of Riviera Beach. 85 members strong.
I love what I do. All of my everything has been music, and I always knew as a little boy that I was going to be a music teacher. Five, six, ready, and!
Woo! So in the SOS Warriors, you don't pay to play, no previous experience required.
We teach all of the kids from scratch, and we have the most important thing is we have a 100% graduation rate.
Tell me what it's like to play the trumpet.
It's like really fun. I like doing it, but it's kind of confusing when I'm trying to figure out the notes because there's only really three keys out of like the woodwinds.
You gonna blow into that horn for me?
I could, but I'm not really that good.
It's good to me.
Besides teaching them instruments, teaching them formations, and teaching them your compositions,
right?
What else are you teaching them?
Oh, this life skills. We pray for our kids all the time. We never leave without prayer. I teach them life traits. Five, six, turn up!
Okay! I feel good because I get to show and mentor some of these kids and be a big brother to them in a sense.
One, two, three!
On the field four nights a week, the Sounds of Success is all ages, all focused, all one big family.
One, two.
Whether in performance in local neighborhoods or packed football stadiums.
You can feel all eyes on you. So it's quite nerve-wracking, but at the same time, it's like you know that you have to do your best.
And what the Warriors have now is the chance to go to London to perform. What they need are donations, lots of them, and soon.
What I hope I'm doing is shifting their perception of life. You know, I hope that I'm guiding them to be future leaders and role models of excellence as I hope that I'm being to them as well, you know. My joy is the end of the year when we have our award ceremony and I'm able to say, man, look, you were accepted to Florida A&M, you were accepted to Bethune-Cookman, whatever school that they applied for.
Maybe what drives Antoine is that night long ago that he chose not to go out with his friends who made a very wrong choice. The very next day, Antoine ran into his old music teacher.
And he basically asked me, what are you doing with your life? And I just went to vent what was going on. He said, you know what? Come up and help my band. So that very next day, my group of friends end up going to jail, but I end up working with band. So to me, it was a lifesaver. It was a change.
A once-in-a-lifetime change that led to this band and this chance to transform 85 lives and counting.
It's only a once-in-a-lifetime for everybody that's in this band. We're the only band in Palm Beach County that's been invited to London. So that says a lot about this band and about our community altogether.
Give me a big ashe!
And Antoine Miller has just one more dream.
One day our day is going to come where we will be funded, but until then it's not going to stop the show. One, two, three!
London Bells 2023!
Well, they definitely have the spirit there, and they're really inspiring, too.
Very inspiring. The SOS Warriors Marching Band has a March 1st deadline to raise $500,000 to get to London.
So they'll be giving a series of performances, but they do need help. We posted a link on how to donate on our website, WPBF.com. All right, now to a different kind of dance that's impacted the lives of thousands of children in Palm Beach County.
And those kids haven't missed a beat, even after a devastating fire that tried to bring them down.
Caleb Califano explains the motivation behind it all.
Try your best to stay positive.
Inside the Digital Vibes studio in West Palm Beach, kids and creativity are the main focus.
Oftentimes, our kids, they have so much emotion built in and they don't know how to express it. And when they do express it, they do it the wrong way and they get in trouble.
Founder Will Romulus understands firsthand how that expression can go wrong. In 2009, he was held at gunpoint and robbed by teens. Instead of shunning the kids for what they did, he wanted to find a solution.
You know what? I'm gonna go ahead and become that mentor that those kids probably didn't have. And then that's how Digital Vibes started. Get your grades up,
homie. Get your grades up. Digital Vibes is all about bringing the right influence to kids across Palm Beach and Martin counties. Get your grades up, sis. Get your grades up. The Black-led nonprofit is now in dozens of schools and growing.
It's
at this point where if we didn't have Digital Vibes, I think all around, Palm Beach County would be hurting.
Liana Farmer and her two kids have been involved in the organization and see them as family. That's why what happened to their bus was so difficult.
When I first heard, I was like, okay, so maybe we can fix it. The insurance will come. And then when they total lost the bus, I was like, okay, what can I do?
Last year, the bus was destroyed by a fire. It was considered the heartbeat of the nonprofit.
The bus is one branch of Digital Vibes. You know, it's one branch. Does it slow us down? Yes. Does it slow us down to a point where it crippled us? No, you know, in that sense. So we're still going strong. But at the same time, the bus really was a big part of that.
While they've got donations, they're still far from the goal of a new bus. Romla says it's the community and families like farmers that will get them through this tough time.
Because we'll give so much. I don't have a lot, but I know people. I know that I could reach out in email. I can reach out to agencies. What could I do to try to give back at least half of what he's given to myself and to other families in the communities?
Gotta get my success on.
It takes two, you know, to change a life. As we changing the kids' life, they're also changing my life as well.
Try to be the best me.
Ahead.
We're proud of not only the ethnic diversity, but the fact that the firm president is a woman.
Empowering women and men, the way one local company is leading the way.
Black workers make up a small part of the engineering workforce in the United States.
And the amount of Black-owned engineering companies is even smaller.
But one firm in West Palm Beach is breaking down those barriers by building an even bigger legacy.
Where are we right now and what are you guys doing here at the site?
Well, right now we're at 4401 Beacon Circle and we're building the future home of ECF Engineering Consultants.
In just a few months, this construction site will be transformed into the firm's state-of-the-art headquarters.
We are constructing a 20,000 square foot facility to accommodate our main office.
Everett Fennell is the firm's founder and CEO, which provides technical, electrical, and mechanical support for companies and agencies like FPL and the Port of Palm Beach. It was founded in West Palm Beach, and it's groundbreaking, not just because of the work they do, but also because of the people doing that work.
We're proud of not only the ethnic diversity, but the fact that the firm president is a woman.
President and COO Shauna Fennell Hawkins is Fennell's daughter, an important representation in a field where not just black people, but also women are underrepresented.
I'm a behind-the-scenes person, but I did realize that my position is unique and that it was important that I be more at the forefront to show our black women that it's attainable.
So how big is this operation as far as workers? Because I know you've been doing this for about 2 to 3 months.
This has been a really active construction site. As you see here, it's a plethora of guys out here working right now. It can range from anywhere from 20 guys to 50 guys, depending on what they're doing that particular day.
They're hoping to grow their business with this new building, which Fennell says will help grow their workforce by 10%.
Compared to your other locations in Broward County and Atlanta, what is the scope of this project compared to those?
This is home. This is as if somebody had a little small chateau in Atlanta or in Broward County, but you had your main home in West Palm Beach. So this will be our home.
We feel based on our success, others can find a way to replicate what we've done. We do work with others, we do mentor others and support others who are pursuing their dreams. It's been a great opportunity. We've been blessed to been in a position to create what we have.
Fennell says he expects to move into the new building later this year. Jobs have already been posted.
Again, we are here at the Spady Museum in Delray Beach, which is open to the public right now. You're welcome to take a walking or bus tour.
The next exhibit will cover the effects of Reconstruction, the era of Jim Crow, and the very recent time of legal segregation in the city.
We thank you for watching Project Community Celebrating Black History. As a country and community, we know the fight for racial equality and justice continues. Our hope is by highlighting these stories, showing the sacrifices and path being forged ahead, we can all live in a better place.
And as you can see, whether it's stories told decades ago or present day, they all play an important role in the rich history of Black culture in our state and our nation. Perseverance, passion, and triumph, they all make up the framework of who we are.